Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us. This is Westcoat's virtual demonstration of our thin film liquid granite and liquid dazzle systems. Today, our presenters are going to be Todd Cook, who is our product manager, and Mike Pittman, who is our application specialist. My name is Mallory Cabading, and I will be your moderator. We do have four different categories of systems. So Westcoat's been manufacturing flooring systems and solutions from San Diego, California for over 30 years. We've used the West and Westcoat to break down these four different categories. So you'll see here the WP, the EC, the SC, and the TC. You will see this along all of our spec sheets and any product line that you will see. The WP section is our waterproofing section, and this is going to be waterproofing for over concrete and waterproofing for over plywood. Those systems are the matte coat and the ALX system. The EC line is our epoxy coat line, and that's what we will discuss today. So today we're going to dive into our thin film systems. We have 100% solids and water-based thin film systems. Our liquid granite system, which you see here, which is typically a paint chip system or a flake chip system. And our liquid dazzle system, which is a metallic epoxy. Our SC category line is our concrete stains and sealers. You can see here we have translucent stains that can be used for interior and exterior applications. And we have about 10 to 15 different types of sealers that you can use on your projects as well. Now our texture coat line is cementitious overlays. So these overlays can be used in interior spaces or exterior spaces. And that is called our texturecrete system. Some prep before we get started. So before you install any of these systems, preparing the concrete, inspecting the concrete is going to be very important. So the concrete should be cured a minimum of 28 days. That is an industry standard number. That does not mean that the concrete is completely cured or doesn't have moisture content in it after 28 days. So we do want to do a moisture test. And for these systems we're going to demonstrate today, what we're looking for is moisture emissions less than 5 pounds per 1,000 square feet or less than 75% relative humidity. I'll show you two different ways to test that out in just a moment. The concrete should be at least 2,500 PSI. So with that, what we're looking for again is a material that we can actually bond to quite well. What we see sometimes is maybe a pour back is done and there's some material that's there that less than 2,500 PSI. We really want to make sure that the substrate we're sticking to can handle the coating that we're putting on top of it. And then the concrete should be free of grease, paint, oil, dust, any curing agents or foreign materials that will prevent proper adhesion. Now for moisture tests, these are two different types of tests that you can do on your project. You could do one or the other, or you could do both, but we definitely recommend that you at least do one of these tests. A relative humidity test is going to measure the moisture content that is present in the concrete slab itself. Again, we're looking for less than 75% relative humidity. If you hit over that number, please reach out to us. We do have moisture vapor barriers and we can help kind of mitigate that for you. Now, a calcium chloride test is actually going to measure the vapor emissions coming out of a concrete slab. So the puck there that you see kind of in the bottom left-hand corner is weighed prior to placing the puck on the ground. And then that plastic dome gets basically taped to the ground on top of that. And you let it sit for 72 hours or 3 days. You weigh the puck after, and then it gives you a measurement of what we're looking for is less than 5 pounds per 1,000 square feet. So again, if you hit over those numbers, just reach out to us and we can help you with your project. Now, what you will see in our specifications for preparation for the concrete substrate itself is a CSP number. So we will call out a CSP maybe 2 or 3 for a thin film system, or a CSP 4 or 5 for a self-leveling topping. And that again is a concrete surface prep number that is put out by ICRI, which is the International Concrete Repair Institute. And again, these are industry standard numbers that we use so that all of our systems call out for a prep that does make sense in the industry. Different types of ways that you can prep the floor to get to these CSP numbers. You'll see on the left is diamond grinding, which is probably the most common for any of the systems we're going to cover today. And that's going to get you a CSP 2 to 3. Now, shot blasting can be done if maybe you have an uneven floor, maybe you're removing an existing coating, and that can get you to a CSP 3 to 5. Scarifying is something we're not going to show a video of today, but something that is done when you're doing a self-leveling topping or maybe a urethane cement, and you actually need to have a much more aggressive prep underneath the coating to be able to have the coating bite to the concrete. So here is an example of a diamond grinder. This is a machine that is has metal abrasives, metal diamond abrasives that go underneath the machine, and they go in the circular motion so that it can kind of hit all of the floor there. What can kind of happen though is if the floor is not perfectly even, if that thing is kind of bouncing around, it might not hit every spot on the floor. So that's something to keep in mind. But for the most part, diamond grinding is going to be the most common method of prep for these thinner sealers systems that we're going to talk about today. Now, shot blasting again may be done if the floor is not kind of, exactly perfect, or if you might be needing to remove an existing coating. A shot blasting machine is going to take tiny metal beads and shoot them down at the ground. And you can see here in this video that they are being shot down at the ground. The machine actually picks them back up and it picks the dust up with it as well. So it's a completely dustless machine and should be picking these metal abrasives up with it. Last thing before we go ahead and get started here is concrete repair and patching. So we do want to make sure that any linear lines have material in them that allow them to function as they need to. But any type of cracks that go through the slab, what you can see here, all of those cracks are patched with a resinous material. And it's a little bit more rigid so that they actually can try to mitigate those cracks from coming back in the future. So that is it for the prep. I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Todd now, and we'll get started with the live demonstration. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Mallory. Appreciate that introduction, and thank you all for tuning in. Good morning, everyone. As mentioned, my name is Todd Cook. I'm product manager here. We're also going to have support for this demonstration with Mike Pittman. Mike, why don't you come on stage real fast? We're doing our best to abide with 6 feet rule here. You can see Mike. Mike is our application specialist. He'll be supporting with all the product demonstrations and putting down the materials today. If you reach us at Westcoat and you are looking for technical support, more than likely you're going to reach out and contact and speak directly with myself or Mike to help with any of your technical questions or, of course, your regional rep. We have a great staff here to help. So what I want to do is, before we start talking about these systems, which again, we're going to talk about our thin film, 100% solids, our liquid granite or liquid terrazzo system, which is a paint chip system, or also our liquid dazzle metallic epoxy system, I want to take a moment and just kind of give a general recap and expand on our EC category, because I think that's really important to just let everyone know all the products and solutions we have. So for example, in the EC category, this is going to be resinous epoxy materials. We're going to have everything from thin films, like Mallory mentioned, 100% solids or water-based. We're going to have a liquid granite system, a paint chip system, which will either have a partial broadcast or a full broadcast. We also have epoxy slurries. We also have a flexible epoxy membrane that can be used as a standalone system or can be used as a membrane underneath numerous systems. We have epoxy mortars, and then we also have urethane cements as well. In addition to that, we have a double broadcast system known as our Dubro, which can be utilized with silica sand or decorative quartz sand. And then we have a full range of other materials that can be used for either primers or specialty top coats. For example, there might be Innovalac, which will offer you greater chemical and heat resistance. We could also have antimicrobial products for those solutions, which is going to be our EC40. And then we have polyurethanes, both water-based and solvent-based, our EC95, available in a gloss and a flat sheen and pigmented or clear. And then we also have the water-based solutions in our SC line. And then, of course, we have polyaspartics to kind of round that out, both in a 100% solids and an 80% solids formula, being our EC101 and our EC102. So really, regardless of your industrial flooring needs, your epoxy or resinous materials, we've got you covered with all the solutions needed, okay? Before we get in and we start talking about some of these systems and kind of actually giving you these live demonstrations, I kind of want to take a moment and talk about an important aspect before you even get to the job site, before you're even doing the work, before you're buying the materials. And that's going to be the interview process. The interview process is really crucial. Now, that starts from the moment you take the call, you talk to the customer, you're interviewing the customer, and you're finding out the needs. Why this is so important is this will really kind of determine what system is needed for the space, what the customer is looking for, and ultimately what you feel comfortable installing on that space as well. Okay. And the reason this is important is during the interview process, the customer may say they want an epoxy floor material, which is a very general, broad term applied to the overall category of epoxies. The reality is you might go to that space and find out that, well, no, they necessitate maybe greater chemical resistance, or they need maybe a low odor water-based solution. Or for example, they may need a higher build. Now, we're going to show you a thin film system here first. Now, the thin film system is a great solution, providing you chemical resistant, thin build, great durable system. But there are some limitations. So for example, you walk this space, you're interviewing the customer, and they say, yeah, I want the thin film system as I've seen. But you look at the existing concrete and slab, and perhaps it's so eroded or the concrete is so damaged that a thin film system is just really not going to be suitable as an option. You're not going to get enough millage or build to fully protect and bring that surface up. And more likely, after you've put down this coating, you're going to see all the surface imperfections, and it's probably not going to meet the use and abuse of the space. So really qualifying what's needed of the system, what the demands and requests are of the client, are going to be really crucial. Now, again, that could vary from many aspects, from chemical resistance, odor, flammability concerns. It might also be something as simple as a UV. Maybe you're bidding a hangar or a garage that has UV exposure, whether it be south-facing direct sun or maybe partial sun. You need to factor that in, and you may need to elect to use a polyurethane or polyaspartic top coat that's going to be UV stable, as opposed to our standard EC34 materials that are just going to be 100% solid epoxy and not UV stable. Another option might be that you need skid resistance. There might be a requirement for a non-skid or a certain skid coefficient required for that facility. That's going to be an important requirement and noted feature, because that's going to depend on either utilizing a non-skid additive like our Safe Grip, which is our CA29, CA30, or CA31, or we also have a full line of CA33 aluminum oxide available in a 36, 60, and 320 grit. Again, kind of dependent on what they're doing. You might use Safe Grips for lighter duty traffic. And then if you're getting into heavier traffic, or you have steel casters, more abrasion, maybe you're doing a larger area with a lot more traffic, heavier duty traffic, then you like to use the aluminum oxide. That aluminum oxide, when suspended in our materials, is going to get you much better abrasion resistance and durability, taking the burden off of the resinous material. So again, those are just kind of some brief points to factor in. Of course, you're going to have color, texture, sheen, and a wide variety of other elements that are really important in the interviewing process. But take time to really do that to qualify what the scope of work is for the project, what the need is of the customer, and what the use and abuse of the space is, so that you can really kind of prescribe, if you will, the best solution and the best system. Now, if you have any questions on what maybe the demands of a client may be, or what possible offerings are available to you, always feel free to reach out to us directly. You can contact us at the 1-800 number. You can contact us through our website, westcoat.com, and you'll be greeted by plenty of amazing human beings that can help direct you into the right solution for your project. Okay. So that's kind of just a general overview on interviewing and just helping you get on the right foot. Because a lot of times we will see the incorrect system used in a situation. And for example, it just might not be appropriate to put that system down. Okay. So next, what we're going to do is we're going to kind of talk a little bit about the inspection aspect of these systems and what you might want to look for. Mallory did a really great job of capturing all the really pertinent content here, so it makes my job a lot easier, thank goodness. But I do want to kind of reiterate some things about, you know, evaluating the substrate. As I mentioned, if you go to a facility and they've had a lot of erosion, water damage, chemical exposure, potential contaminants that have been leaching into the substrate, for example, oil contamination, things of this nature, you want to do kind of be conscious of this, because that could affect either the adhesion, the requirement of what primer to use, or what system to be used. But always evaluate the substrate, okay? We're going to be looking for, obviously, the surface profile that's going to be needed for these systems. So in our system specs or our technical data sheets, you're going to find a clear guide that will say, for example, prepare to a profile of CSP 2 to 3. Prepare to a profile of CSP 3. This is all in accordance with ICRI, or International Concrete Repair Institute's guidelines, which kind of help create a standardized index or scale of surface preparation. For those that may not know, there's a helpful resource or tool that's available. So for example, here, and you can see this, I'll try and get a little close up of that for you. You can see here, we have these CSP chips. These are really nice, and these are available tools that you can download on iCry's website. Now, what these do is they provide you with a nice reference, a visual reference, and a textural reference that you can actually feel. So for example, you can go onto your job site and say it's requiring a surface prep of CSP 3 to 4. You can go to these, evaluate, look at these, put them down on your floor, and make sure that you're meeting that surface requirement. Now, this may be a crucial mandate for example, if you're installing an MVB material, or just ensuring that you have proper adhesion for the coating. Kind of in a, just a general sense, the greater the surface prep is related to the thicker the coating for the most part. So for example, if we're gonna be putting down a thin mill system of say, you know, 12 to 15 mils, it's probably not gonna be appropriate to get into say a CSP 9 or 10. It's just never gonna hide that surface texture that was created by that mechanical profile. So kind of be aware of this, reference these. And again, these are just really helpful tools that you can use to educate yourself, your team, your customers, and also just kind of double check to make sure that you're meeting those surface requirements. Again, with inspection and with surface preparation methods, there's quite a variety available of tools, machines. For the most part today, what we're going to be talking about are systems that are in approximately the CSP 2 to 3 range, maybe into the 3 to 4 range when we talk about the MVB or the moisture vapor barriers that require a little bit more tooth or profile in the substrate and to anchor. So again, as Mallory mentioned, one of the most common methods for surface preparation is going to be using a planetary grinder, okay, stand-up grinder, which would have a head like this affixed to it. This turns independently, and the machine actually turns independently, creating that planetary effect. On this head or plate, you will find multiple diamond segments. These segments look like this, and I can zoom in here and kind of show you for those that may not be quite as familiar. Now, they come in all varieties, okay? So you definitely want to be familiar with these. For example, these ones right here, approximately 60, 80 bits metal bond diamonds. And these are very commonly used for creating a surface profile of approximately CSP 1 to 2. Great for, you know, thin film or sealers, so forth like that. But you put this onto your planetary grinder, this will go ahead and prep. And that's a great way to get yourself in a CSP of approximately CS2. Now, other options available to you would be hand tooling. Hand tooling is something that is definitely something that we should mention, because there's areas where you're not going to be able to reach and detail with these larger machines. So handheld angle grinders, for example, like this 4.5 or 7 inch are great tools. All kinds of various options and tooling available as well. For example, you can see a metal bond here, very common, as you can see this little Zec disc. This is often used for removal processes, not typically the best for actual surface prep because it could hone or smooth out the concrete. Regardless of any methods that you use, you want to make sure that you're not prepping too smooth or too aggressively. Okay, that's a really key factor here, because you could prep again for a thin film system and you could all of a sudden maybe overblast the floor with shot. And for example, then you put down, you know, 12 mils or so of a product, you're not going to hide that. So it's really crucial that you do the appropriate surface prep to match the system in which it is intended for. So after we've done our surface preparation, we've prepared the whole floor, we've cleaned out all of our cracks and joints. The appropriate way to do that, and you'll see in our spec, is typically using that grinder that I just showed you with a flat blade like this. This is the most common thing that you can see. I'll try and zoom in here and see if you can see that. This is gonna be typically a 1/4 inch by 1/4 inch approximate dimension, and this will fit on your angle grinders. Obviously, you want to make sure you're using dustless means, vacuum setups, of course, to reduce any airborne contaminants or particulates in the air, and then obviously having respirators and the proper PP always. But what you want to do is you want to route out all of your cracks in anticipation for filling them with either a rigid material or a semi-rigid or a flexible material, again, depending on what system and what the joints are. A general rule is if they're moving joints, now that could be moving joints or moving cracks, you typically want to always honor those, okay? Because they're still moving. So routing those out after you've cleaned out the system, filling them if needed with, for example, a flexible polyurea joint filler material is the most common method. But there are aspects where you may just leave the expansion joint. Now, if it is non-moving or non-moving joint or crack, we're going to treat the crack. Sometimes you will hear crack repair. Well, the reality is we're treating the crack. There's no full guarantee that if this moving crack or this, you know, semi-moving crack, or we don't know, sometimes we're just on a project and we don't know if it's moving or not. We're going to do the best we can to determine that. Or maybe ask the customer, you know, is this still moving? Has this movement stopped? Do you still see it occurring? We're going to do our best to try and, you know, prescribe the best treatment, but we can't always determine. And if there is a crack that is still moving, and the customer asked to, you know, bury it, for example, there is a chance that that could re-crack. And then what happens is it re-cracks through the system, okay? So you do want to just be mindful of if it's moving or not moving. And we have details on our website that kind of refer to how to treat these as well as approaches. Regardless of your cracks being moving or not moving, the non-moving cracks or dormant cracks, we're going to show you how to do that and prep for that right now, okay? And that kind of starts with our thin film system. But this same treatment of treating cracks will really apply to most of the systems that we're going to demonstrate today. But if you do have any questions, please refer back to our system specification sheets and our technical data sheets, as well as our training videos that are available online. Or again, if you have any questions, you contact us directly and we'll help you out. But that's going to kind of kickstart, and we're going to now go ahead and kick off the thin film system, okay? So for the thin film system, this is a great, great system that we have. It is a cost-effective way to treat your concrete and to give yourself a really, really nice way to provide a monolithic seamless coating with a two-step process. The first process involves priming with our EC12 epoxy primer, which is 100% solid dedicated primer. We finished it with a EC34 epoxy top coat, okay? Now, there are other top coat available. For example, you could use a polyaspartic, like our EC101 or 102. You could utilize our EC95. You could utilize our Novolac, antimicrobial, or we also have water-based options for the system as well, utilizing our EC11 water-based epoxy, or you could also utilize our SC65 water-based polyurethane, which is also available in clear or pigmented, okay? But for today's purposes, we're going to demonstrate a two-step process utilizing EC12 and EC34. And so you can kind of see the system. Great system for garages, for aircraft hangars, anywhere where you need a thin build system. This is going to be a great way to provide a monolithic, seamless, chemical resistant epoxy coating. So as I mentioned, we're going to go ahead and start with crack treatment. So what we have here on these boards is, you can see, obviously we don't have the concrete substrate in front of us, so we're kind of simulating the effect of what a crack might be. So what I'll have these guys kind of zoom in on, and I know it's a little hard to read virtually, of course, but as you can see on this board, we've gone ahead and created these cracks here, these simulated cracks, to kind of give you an idea of what you might see on the job site. Now again, you'd want to always cut these out with your quarter inch diamond blade, route these out, clean out any loose matter, make sure they're nice and clean and free of any kind of loose contaminants, debris, so forth. This is going to ensure that we get proper adhesion and our material can properly get into this joint and won't blow out with any loose material. So the first thing we're going to have you guys see is the application of our EC72 epoxy patch gel. Now, we also have an EC75 material as well, which is a little bit more flexible version. So if you have a little bit more movement or you're requiring a little bit more elongation out of your product, we do have that solution available, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to pan over here, And we're gonna show Mike Pittman mixing this material together. So Mike, why don't you come on to the mix site here? And so the first thing you're gonna notice is the color of the material. This is a very simple product to use. It is a A and a B material. So this is a 2K or two component product. You have contrasting colors, so you can easily distinguish between your part A and your part B. And you're going to mix this a ratio of 1:1 by volume, okay? So you do want to make sure that with any mixing, you're mixing it properly and you're mixing it provided by the specifications recommendation or mix ratio. So in this case, a 1:1 by volume. Mike's gone ahead and weighed all those out or measured those out correctly. And now he's going to mix these together. So it's pretty common to see that this is going to be mixed with, you know, like a putty knife or some type of means. If you're having more volume, you can mix it with a drill in a bucket. It is a little bit thicker of a viscosity product, so you really want to make sure you're taking your time to mix this product really, really well. One thing that you'll notice is when the material is really mixed properly to a homogeneous mix, is you'll start to get a unified concrete color or Cape Cod kind of concrete-esque color. This is a nice target color because this will also help reduce it from telegraphing or ghosting through. Some other patching materials will sometimes be darker, and that will sometimes cause hide issues in your primer or even sometimes your top coats. So we've designed this product to be very concrete-esque in color, so it's a lot more complementary and will blend in a lot better and thus hide in your additional coats. So you can see Mike's gone ahead and mixed that really well. You can see that we've got a nice homogeneous mix, even color, no streaks. Now he's gonna come over to this board here and he's ready to apply the material. So after the material has been activated, with any two component or 100% solids material, the clock is going, right? So we definitely want to apply this in a speedy manner, but paying attention to detail. So as you can see, Mike's first gonna go ahead and start kind of cross hatching and going perpendicular methodology to the joint or the crack, okay? He's working the material in. Then you notice he comes back and smooths it out. This is gonna reduce any excessive ridges and help drive the material into the crack. Now, when utilizing epoxies, you typically do not need to use any type of sand or any type of reinforcement tape. But if you're using the same methodology to receive, say, for example, a cementitious topping, micro topping, overlay materials, you would definitely want to ensure that you used a reinforcing tape and a broadcast of sand to promote adhesion. But because epoxies are going to like each other and they're going to marry, we're going to utilize the EC72 and be able to go directly into that after it's dried, approximately 2 to 4 hours, with our EC12 epoxy primer. Now, in some cases, you might want to choose to leave the material slightly high and then come back and grind it flush. It's all going to be dependent on the joints, the cracks, and what's occurring on the project. But as you can see, Mike's doing a good job here of working this material in. Now, there's a lot of other ways to treat cracks. There's gravity filling and so forth. But this is kind of the standard method that gives you a fast turnaround, very durable, and again, this is a great way to treat cracks. So again, that's going to typically dry about 2 to 4 hours. All these dry times are always going to be based on approximately 70 to 72 degrees. So of course, keep that in mind. If we're in the winter months and we have slower temperatures, we do need to be mindful of that. Of course, obviously when we're summer times or we have conditioned spaces, we're going to have accelerated dry times and faster drying times associated with that. So that is the patching methodology that's going to apply for pretty much all the systems you're going to see today. And really, for the most part, almost every system in our EC category will be treated the same way, except for when we talk about urethane cements. Okay, so just kind of please note that and refer to the specifications with regarding patching, surface preparation, and crack treatment. Next, what we're going to do is we're going to go over to our board that's already been patched and dried, you know, kind of have this nice simulated effect here for you guys virtually. And we're going to demonstrate the application of our EC12 epoxy primer. So Mike will go ahead and mix together EC12. One thing to note about the EC12 is it is our dedicated epoxy primer, okay? This material is specifically engineered and designed for use directly over concrete. And there's a few reasons why. One, it's lower viscosity, helps to aid in penetration and soak in of the concrete. Additionally, it has excellent moisture tolerance. So as Mallory had mentioned earlier, when concrete slabs are 5 pounds or under, or 75% RH or under, the EC12 is an appropriate solution. If your moisture levels exceed those, for example, 6-7 pounds or so forth, or 85%, 90% relative humidity, we want you to look at our EC15 material, which is a moisture vapor barrier. We will demonstrate that in the next system in the liquid granite. So you will kind of be exposed to that and aware of that solution, but always test for moisture. The most common reasons we see coating failure in our industry is going to be surface preparation, usually lack of or improper methods, and moisture related issues coming up through the slab, pushing off a coating, which again, typically can be treated and supported and combated against by using proper mechanical profiling and the appropriate moisture vapor barrier solution. So we're going to go ahead and pan over here to Mike Pittman. He's going to go ahead and mix the EC12. This EC12 product is a 2-to-1 by ratio. It comes in a 1.5 gallon kit, also available in 15 gallon kits and drums. We have this in clear and pigmented available. So a lot of options depending on what you need to have. Generally speaking, you're in the thin film system, you're going to utilize a pigmented material to hide. Now you'll notice Mike's going to go ahead and mix his materials together. He's ensuring that he gets all of the material out of the cans. Now you can see over to his side, we have the original packaging. Again, 1.5 gallon, 15 gallon or drum units available. We also have for demonstrations or for mock-ups, what you can see him utilizing. These are our sample cans. These liquid samples are available upon request for any of our applicators and customers. So Mike's gonna go ahead and mix this together. Now, one thing you'll notice is Mike has his stopwatch ready. This is a great, great thing to remember. This is going to ensure that he's mixing it for the proper time. Additionally, Mike's gonna be using a low RPM drill. He's not going to be whipping and inducing a lot of air into the product. That will create bubbles that can sometimes then translate to the floor coating, and then you can have issues and surface defects. So he's utilizing a low RPM speed, he's monitoring his mixing times, and this will all ensure for a nice homogeneous mix. So as Mike is mixing this material, we want to just remind you that we also have a water-based product available as well. So if you do require a water-based solution, that would be our EC11. But again, recall for all of these systems, the standard epoxy primer is going to be our EC12. It's dedicated for that. We do get questions sometimes from customers asking, you know, why EC12 than EC34? And again, it is that lower viscosity, that moisture tolerance. It's intended to be a dedicated primer. Now, people say, can I use EC34 or other materials as a priming agent? You can, but you might sacrifice certain physical properties or adhesion or moisture tolerance. Additionally, your EC34 is really dedicated as the final top coat. So we don't typically recommend that people utilize the EC12 as the final top coat for that matter as well, okay? So Mike has gone ahead and mixed this material up. He's going to apply this onto the substrate that's been properly prepared. Again, free of grease, contaminants, other types of debris. Our patching material is dried. Now, typical methods for application would typically be a squeegee and back roll methodology. We are going to look for this material to be nice and thin. Now, the primer is intended to kind of soak in and drive into the material. You can additionally add approximately 1 to 2 quarts during that mixing process. Now, we have a proprietary thinner here called our CA23. That's an amazing thinner that can help reduce the viscosity and help drive in the EC12 when you're doing your direct priming applications. Alternatively, though, you could use, you know, whatever local solvent you have, for example, like acetone, xylene, where appropriate. But the CA23 is going to be very nice because it's going to give you extended working times. It's also VOC compliant, which means you can use it anywhere in the U.S. with any concerns of VOC restrictions. And again, it's going to help extend that pot life and working time of your materials really well. And that's our CA23. So you can see Mike's ensuring that he's rolling edge to edge, maintaining a wet edge. And again, nice and thin. We're not looking for a high build on this first coat because we really want it to soak in, penetrate into the concrete, and get ourselves a really, really nice bond to receive our EC34 top coat that we applied. But as you can see, we're getting good opacity, good hide out of the EC12 material, even at this thinner rate, hiding our patching materials and helping to unify and give us a kind of a semi-sealed surface to receive this coating. Now, Mike would always ensure that he's maintaining a wet edge. If you are working in an area where you do have joints, expansion joints, moving joints, you do want to ensure that all those joints would be cleared and you brush the material out or clean the material out as you go. Of course, if material were to flood those joints, you would want to remove that material and ensure that you're honoring that joint as well. Now, I would also take a moment here to just kind of reiterate, we are in colder months in a lot of, you know, areas. You know, we're here in San Diego, so sometimes, you know, we're fortunate that we don't get quite as colder temperatures as certain other areas. But that said, we do have some additives here that can help support when you are in the colder months. For example, we have an epoxy accelerator that you can see here. The epoxy accelerator is our CA35 material, and this can be added to any of our 100% solids epoxy materials to help expedite and speed up your dry times. This is gonna be really crucial when we're talking about colder temperatures or when you need a faster turnaround on a job site. So there's the question on what is the appropriate tool? Typically, again, as I mentioned, a squeegee and back roll with a roller cover, approximately 1/4 inch, 3/8, depending on, again, your surface prep. But the squeegee application is going to help to expedite the flow of the material onto a larger scale. Obviously, for demonstration purposes here, we have 16 square feet. So putting a squeegee on this would be a little bit ridiculous. But when you're on a large job site, you want to use a squeegee. Squeegees come in a lot of different offerings. For example, you could have a flat blade squeegee, which will help to gauge your material in a much thinner methodology and spread that a lot further. Great for top coats and primers. Now, if we're starting to talk about greater mill thickness being desired, some of these thicker notch squeegees, for example, here are really, really great. What's great about Midwest Rake Company, who supplies these materials, is they've gone from various dimensions of the actual notch to standardized mills, which really, really makes it easy because a lot of times it's hard to translate 1/4 inch by 1/4 inch notch or 1/8 inch by 1/8 inch notch. Whereas here you can say it specifically states 15 to 20 mils, you kind of know your target rate and yield. Again, assuming it's 100% solids material, your wet film to dry film thickness. If we were doing a material that was not 100% solids, of course, we'd want to factor in that wet film to dry film differential. But be aware of those various tools and methods that are available. The other thing I would always remind people is quality tools. Okay, we're talking about a thin film system here that has two coats. It has a primer with the EC12 that you just saw, and we're gonna have a finish coat here of our EC34. A lot of time applicators will say, just get the cheapest roller cover you can. It doesn't matter. It's not a big deal. Put it down. It's the farthest thing from reality, and everyone probably is shaking their heads and agreeing because they know the issues associated with cheaper roller covers. Now, we often recommend or endorse the use of, say, the Wooster Produce Z. There's a lot of other application tools out there, but higher quality epoxy-rated roller covers are really going to make or break the difference. Now, I know that sounds simple when you're talking about a $2 difference or a $4 difference in a roller cover, but the reality is what happens is it translates to the floor. If you're using a roller cover that sheds constantly, even if you do the tape method, it still is gonna leave debris and contaminants on the floor. And what happens is in a thin film system where we don't have enough mill thickness to hide, that's gonna be extremely crucial. So what that means is after you've used a cheaper quality roller cover, you're gonna have all this debris in your primer coat and or possibly in your finish coat. That's going to then require the applicator and your team to go back there, sand the floor down to remove all of that surface debris, acetone wipe or solvent wipe, remove all that, and reapply just because of an inferior or lower quality roller cover being elected. So kind of when you're doing thin film systems, or really generally any kind of high-end finish systems like what we're talking about today, definitely consider utilizing higher quality roller covers. You'll notice the difference, and you'll notice the difference in your finish. So that was the application of our EC12 that you saw here. Again, we're going to allow that to dry, okay? In approximately about 6 to 8 hours, give or take, on our temperatures. Again, please refer to technical data sheets and system specification sheets on the actual dry times. Again, typically all going to be at 72 degrees. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to have the guys come in, and they're going to go ahead and remove this EC72 patch board and our EC12. Perfect. So they're going to go ahead and move these out. And then next, we're going to show you the application of our EC34 epoxy top coat. Now, as these guys bring this board out and bring the other one in and so forth, I do want to mention that we have this color chart reference here, which hopefully you guys can read that with our lighting. For example, this is our standard top coat color chart. This is going to be for all of our industrial products. For example, this is going to apply to EC12, EC34, EC95, which is our polyurethane. This is going to apply to any of our polyspartic materials. So you'll notice we have standard colors here, okay? And then we also have white and black, and then we have safety values here. So you can see those as well. Safety red, safety yellow, safety blue, and a safety green, all available, meeting your kind of OSHA or facility requirements for any type of advisory striping, okay? If you have any questions on product availability, what colors are for what products, feel free to contact us. We can help you out with that. We also have liquid samples available. Additionally, to support you, we have cured swatches of every single color that we offer. So anything you need to present to a customer for a mock-up, for any type of display, if you're just wanting these for great sales tools, reach out to us directly, and we have these free of charge for you, and we can get these to you. You can also reach out to your local distributor. Any of your Westcoat approved distributors who stock our materials carry cured samples, and they can help support you getting these to you as fast as possible. In addition to the 3x3 cured swatches here that show the finish, now these are going to show color, possibly non-skid finishes available, we are able to supply you with process samples that you can see here. So this process sample is a 3x6, and it indicates the overall steps and processes. So for example, this is the thin film that you're seeing right now being demonstrated. We have the concrete layer, we have the primer layer, and then we have the top coat layer of the EC34. Everything is labeled appropriately on the back. You have a clear understanding of what the system is, what colors you utilize, and our address, phone number, and information is on there. We'll also reference batch numbers, so you can refer to that information as well. That helps us with quality control, of course. On these tools are really helpful. And again, always know we have liquid samples as originally shown, so that you can do your own mock-ups for a project, okay? So now we're gonna go ahead and talk and demonstrate the EC34 epoxy top coat. So again, as I mentioned, we have an EC12 primer that you saw demonstrated there. Now we're going to utilize the EC34 epoxy top coat. This has a medium viscosity, so it's a little bit increased body or viscosity over the EC12 product. It also has a little bit better ability to protect against UV. Now it's not UV stable, but it will provide much better lasting color and ambering resistance over the EC12 material. That's an important attribute because a lot of applicators will say, well, why would I just use two coats of EC12? It's primarily for that functionality as well, in addition to the viscosity and build. EC12 designed to penetrate, thin application, dedicated primer. Your EC34 is a really great workhorse, utilitarian, 100% solids, pigmented material. Not to be confused with, for example, our EC32, which is a clear product. The EC34 is only pigmented, but is definitely intended to get you higher build and mill thickness. Now, the EC12 primer, that was applied at approximately 250 to 300 square feet per gallon. When we're going to the top coat application in our thin film system, we're reducing our coverage rates to approximately 100 to 200 square feet per gallon. So we're getting more build and more mill thickness out of this. So what we're going to do now is we're going to pan over to Mike and he's going to mix his product. It's going to be very, very similar to what we saw in the EC12. He's got his mixing vessel. He's got his timer. You notice that he's applying his hardener first. Some basic techniques and kind of just reminders here when you're mixing is you always want to typically put in your hardener or your material first that's going to be kicking. You don't want to typically avoid splashing the product onto the sidewalls of the mixing bucket or the vessel. That would potentially cause issues that you might not get 100% everything mixed. And then what happens is if you don't fully mix these products, you will see delays in dry times. You could potentially see soft spots on the floor. It could affect the overall physical attributes of the material as well. So you might sacrifice some chemical resistance, hardness, elongation, flexibility, so forth. So always ensure that you're doing proper mixing. Now, this is a funny part because a lot of times crews will often put the new guy on the mixing station. And you know, it's a kind of a funny thing where the new guy's always put onto the mixing site, you know, and he or she is just thrown in there and maybe they're not as familiar with the mixing process. The reality is this step is absolutely crucial. So Mike, you know, he's here, he's got his stopwatch ready. He's got all of his PPE on. He's ready to go. He's mixing this properly. He's ensuring that the product is mixed for 3 to 5 minutes. And then we get a nice homogeneous mix with a low RPM drill as well. So I'll let him finish up on that. So again, as you can see, Mike's mixing that thoroughly, ensuring a proper mix. You know, the most common thing that we'll hear is my floor's still wet. My floor's tacky. The epoxy's not drying. What happened? How did this happen? Well, the most common reasons for that are one, mix ratio. If you are off on your mix ratio, again, this product being a 2-to-1 by volume, that could affect the dry time, that could affect the hardness and the overall physical characteristics of the epoxy. If you do not mix it for the full 3 to 5 minutes, that can negatively affect the performance, causing dry time issues, possibly relating to the material never being mixed. You know, we joke, but it's not really that funny when you're on the job site and you have 1,000 square feet or 5,000 square feet of epoxy and it's not dry and it's wet. And to remove that is a pretty invasive process and it's not very fun. Also, additionally, you just have to reapply and, you know, repurchase all that material. Again, mixing is a crucial step and really should ensure that you're following all the specifications regarding mixing times, mix ratios appropriately. So now that Mike has properly mixed this material, we're going to apply the EC34. This is in Travitan directly over our pre-primed board of EC12 Travitan. Again, we're using complementary colors here so that we have adequate hide. You typically would want to avoid utilizing a contrasting primer color so that, you know, you're not fighting opacity or hide of your products. Now, again, best practice here would be typically to use squeegee and back roll methodology. Again, using high quality roller covers, you could typically utilize anywhere from a flat squeegee to a notch squeegee, all dependent on your mill thickness or desired build. Now, spec coverage rate for this step is going to be 100 to 200 square feet per gallon. I will say that you can add additional top coats. For example, you could add another coat of our EC34 for additional hide. For example, maybe you need a little bit more build. But do be mindful that if you are kind of prescribing or utilizing a thin film system, that your surface preparation reflects that. Again, if you have a CSP 3 or 5 or the substrate was so badly damaged, you might not want to consider the thin film system and you may want to look at utilizing, say, our epoxy slurry, epoxy mortar, maybe a urethane cement system like our Tempercrete, which will give you more build and hide that floor and even out the surface, again, providing you more build and more durability. So Mike's gone ahead and rolled that out. Again, this material is typically going to dry about approximately 68 hours, 72 degrees. Again, all dependent on your temperatures. One thing that I do want to mention is, you know, we've conditioned this space to approximately 72 degrees. But if you are in a space where you don't have that luxury, do your best to condition your materials, okay? That might be bringing them in or conditioning them in such a way. I've had guys that have had them in their trucks. Because if your materials are stored at, say, 40 degrees Fahrenheit, you're going to see a little bit of a delay. Also, keep in mind that if you, you know, might also see variances in the viscosity as well, which might affect how the products lay out, level and flow. Now, also, if you have control of climatizing the space, getting yourself a heater or anything like that, please utilize those methods. Obviously, ensure that your air systems have been cleaned, you don't have excessive debris or contaminants from the grinding and surface preparation methods that might blow in onto the wet epoxy, of course. But conditioning the space is ideal, but do be mindful that if you have maybe a space that's conditioned, but your slab might still be cold, that you could see delays in dry times, okay? That is very possible, especially when we're in these winter months and we have colder temperatures across the country, okay? So that really concludes the thin film system, okay? Now, again, I do want to mention, we applied the EC12 that you saw, the primer, our dedicated epoxy primer. We just applied the EC34 epoxy top coat, available in all of our standard colors. I do want to also remind you guys that there's a variety of other additional optional top coats that can be utilized. And you may say, well, why? Why would I want to use some of these other top coats in addition to, say, just the EC12 and the EC34? And the reason could be, for example, antimicrobial. For example, maybe you have an animal care facility, a kennel, or a veterinarian's clinic. That would require or maybe potentially benefit from the use of an antimicrobial epoxy, like our EC40. You might have a project where you have sun exposure. Let's say you're doing a large hangar and you need to combat the UV rays that are coming in. In that case, you'd want to look at utilizing our EC95, which is a CRU, polyurethane, and that comes in a pigmented material as well, and you could do it in the same complementary color, for example, like in the Travitan, or you could utilize our polyaspartic materials, which would be an EC101, which is 100% solid material, or our EC102, which is 80% material. Both of those products are going to give you UV stability, can be applied directly over our epoxy top coats. Now, with any of these epoxy materials, also with the epoxy materials you're going to see before, you do typically have pot lives, as I mentioned, but you also have recoat windows. So really be mindful of these recoat windows, okay? We're obviously installing things here within a 24-hour recoat window. Now, at 24-hour recoat windows, again, it's 72 degrees. So that means if you have elevated temperatures, it might not necessarily be at 24 hours. It might drop down. We might now be at 17, 18. But do be mindful of that, okay? If you go past that recoat window, you typically are going to need to abrade and solvent wipe that epoxy to help create a mechanical profile to receive the next top coat. Now, that's a crucial factor because you could see crawling and other issues associated with that if you go past that recoat. But it's always best to try and schedule the things as best as you can. I know a lot of times you're, you know, at the mercy of the GC, the trades, and other aspects. But do be mindful of that, and you typically want to try and schedule things within a recoat window. So, for example, if you're putting down the product, you know, on Monday, try and get back on a Tuesday. You know, a couple other little things that weren't really featured in that primer, or really in any of these epoxy steps, is be mindful of dew point and be mindful of the appropriate times to install coatings. Often, it's best practice to install your coatings towards the end of the day as temperatures are falling and everything's going back down in the concrete, whereas versus early in the morning, everything's rising. What that can sometimes attribute or translate to is excessive off-gassing or bubbling, especially in your primer coats, but sometimes even in your top coats. So do be kind of careful and conscientious of that and installing these products in the ideal times of the day. Now, I know that doesn't always work and we're always kind of at the mercy of when we need to get there. And sometimes we just want to get it done early in the morning. But if it is advantageous, especially in a thin film system where we don't have a lot of mill or we don't have a lot of build or a lot of layers, to utilize that. One last thing, I talked about optional top coats available. We also have available non-skid additives. For example, our Safe Grip. So I'll try and pull this up to the camera. Our safe grip, as you can see here, is available in the CA29, CA30, and CA31. Basically three grits, giving you kind of a mini, a small, and a large profile. This will all translate to how aggressive the non-skid. This material can get mixed directly into any of the epoxy materials that we see here, typically at a ratio of 1 unit, which is approximately 32 ounces, to 3 gallons of epoxy. Now, if you're utilizing this with other materials, for example, acrylic lacquers or SC10 acrylic top coats, you typically would change that ratio and go down to 1 32-ounce container per 5 gallons of material. But again, please refer to the product specification sheets on these products. They have more instructions on mixing, application methods, and so forth. We also have the aluminum oxide, as I mentioned, which typically is not going to be mixed in. The 320 grit or the finer grits can be mixed in, but most of the time with your coarser grits, your 36 and your 60 grits, they're typically going to be broadcasted into the wet film and back rolled accordingly. Yeah, anywhere from approximately 4 pounds, 6 pounds per 1,000 square feet is a general starting point, but always with any non-skid, with any colors, with any textures, do a mock-up. On-site mock-ups are so crucial to indicate the overall finish, whether it be sheen, texture, look, hide, to help indicate the finish for the customer, the owner, any of the inhabitants, anyone that's going to be directly related to the approval of that site and the function of that site.